marinate on that for a minute. Kia ora and welcome to the Niche Cache Variety Show, where we run a bit of a smorgasbord across Kiwi's sporting topics in typical Niche Cache fashion. As always, you can link up to our Monday and Friday email banger. Comes straight into your email. Just head on over to thenichecache.substack.com and you'll get all our work coming into your email, as well as a couple of extra bits and pieces that we put in the underground email slot. And the best way to support the Niche Cache and the Niche Cast and the Niche Cache Variety Show and anything that we are doing is on Patreon. So shout out to all our patrons who keep a bit of food in our belly and a bit of petrol in our tanks. And of course, we are now heading into the Olympic cycle, and that means that we are doing almost daily Olympic podcasts when that comes around. So not only do you get some good karma, some good juju coming your way for supporting the Niche Cache on Patreon, we are also going to be doing almost daily Olympics podcasts, which will basically serve as an audio diary of the Olympics. So we're going to be doing those on an almost daily basis, covering all the Kiwis at the Olympics, and it's going to be plenty of fun. Got a bit of a fizz on that we will discuss in a jiffy. And of course, and the Patreon is patreon.com/LEL Niche Cache. So L as in Spanish, EL, and then Niche Cache in regular English. Why? Because that's what we do. It's a bit of numero tahi. We mix up the languages, get a bit of English, bit of Māori, bit of Spanish, whatever we want to do. Because it's the fucking Niche Cache Variety Show. And we are the Niche Cache. And that's what we're here for. And we're always writing about Kiwi sports at the niche-cache.com. Wobbly wildcard. What have you got coming out of that PowerPoint socket of mindfulness today?
The PowerPoint socket. I'm going back to the well of me old mate Thich Nhat Hanh, who says, "We have to walk in a way that we only print peace and serenity on the earth. Walk as if you are kissing the earth with your feet."
Well, so it's a bit difficult for everyone to walk like that because, you know, we all walk a bit differently. But I guess as long as you're putting out that positive vibration, it doesn't matter how you're actually physically walking. It's about that connection and that energy that you're putting out there, right?
Yeah, I mean, I went for a run this morning, so I don't know how that applies in the literal sense. I think generally when we're talking about how we walk on the earth, it's probably is more of a metaphorical thing. It's like how we act, how we the mindset that we carry, the, you know, just because when he says like walk in a way that prints, that only prints peace and serenity on the earth, I don't think he cares if you stomp a little bit on the dirt. I think it's a little bit more about like not destroying rainforests and polluting the skies and like dumping you know, plastics and landfills and things like that. I think that's probably a little bit more of the bigger picture in that quote.
Lovely jubbly. We are gonna, typical variety show fashion, to start the week, we just have a couple of different topics that we're going to run through in a hard and fast type of manner, but it is a bit of a smorgasbord, lots of different little pockets of funk to explore. And Wildcard, I want to start by going backwards a bit. A couple of variety shows ago, maybe the last one, I expressed a bit of Olympic buzz, and then, well, at the same time, I'm watching the Euros go on. And then at the same time, we've got this vision of the Almost Daily Olympics podcast coming into fruition. And it's got a bit of a fizz, bit of an excitement going on. And I think it just all fell under the umbrella of being excited for tournament type sport and major event type sport, because we exist and we dwell in these leagues and how these leagues are run and the rules and far out everything else, you know, like there's massive blowout score lines that make competitions less fun. You've got rule changes mid-season. Interesting comparison between the NRL and Major League Baseball, where the rule changes are mid-season, bit of a kerfuffle, no surprises there. And you can get into the nitty-gritty of these league competitions where it just gets a bit tedious. They want to make these league competitions longer and longer and longer because that means more broadcasting revenue, and they just play more and more games, and the games kind of suck at some point. It's all just a bit, get a bit of league fatigue. Then you have these major events and these major tournaments where you got the Euros, you got the Olympics, and I think, especially in this current climate, where we've had 2020 and the only thing that was forcing sports to get back into business was the business, and sports business is all about the leagues. So when sports started up again, it was all about the leagues and those competitions continuing to flow on. Now we're getting a bit of tournament hype, and I think just seeing the reactions to the Euros and how fun that tournament style is, I love it. And now we're going into the Olympics, where a lot of the Olympic sports are broken down into tournament type of brackets, and you're going to have those high intensity moments where someone or teams are competing for a gold medal and stuff like that. Like, that's, I had to think about this for a week or so and just meditate on it. I think that's the nugget, is that there is still immense value and excitement and just hype around tournaments and major events as we're currently getting.
Yeah, and there's, yeah, there are, I don't know. It mixes up the, it's something fresh and exciting for sure. Like, it takes you out of that, I love that phrase, league fatigue. It takes you out of that for sure. Like, definitely it's something to, it's just something different, that's always exciting, you know. Variety is the spice of life, or whatever that saying is. But there's something else to it as well, eh? Like, it's just something about the, I mean, definitely the Olympics, and when you wait 4 years for it to come around, and because of that, like, the scarcity of it does mean less business, for sure. Like, the reason the league stuff is what the sponsors and stuff focus on is because it's so regular, it's so often, it's like the most exposure possible. Like, that's why the money flows into those kind of things. But obviously these big, like, the Olympics are enormous financially, and that's why they're happening. Otherwise, even then, they might still be a little bit skeptical as to whether they would go ahead. Especially with the, like, there's a political situation in Japan and all sorts. Like, the Japanese public really don't want a bunch of people from different countries coming into their country, like, coming into their nation at this point in time. That's not ideal for anyone at the moment, but that's kind of not how the Olympics works. Once you agree to host the Olympics in your city, the IOC pretty much just comes in and runs it like it's their own little nation within your nation for a little while, and you don't have a lot to say in the matters once you've signed them papers. But, like, there's something to that, the scarcity of it, and, like, it's not just how it works in difference to the league, which is, like, the league format of events, that's definitely for sure, that's part of it. But also there's something about, like, the peaking for this one big event, and because you only get a couple chances in an entire career, some sports are different than that, you know. Like, gymnasts peak at, like, 17, when you go into the Olympics, sort of thing, and by the time, like, you might only get two goes at it, or you might even not get that, like, by the time you come around, there's another wave of competitors come, like, pushing you off the deep end. Like, it's like, I don't know, because there is definitely a dirty financial aspect to these kind of things as well. Like, that's still there, of course, but there is something kind of beautiful and something that, like, that gets to the essence of what sport is supposed to be, when you get, like, this all or nothing, and it's not all about, like, you know, someone's going to win a gold medal in each event. That's amazing. That's the pinnacle of their careers. That's great. There's also a lot of people who aren't, and there's going to be a lot of people who are disappointed. And that's kind of the thing about sport, is you win and you lose, and you probably lose a lot more than you win. And not everyone gets that reward of the championship at the end of the day, whether they deserve it or not. Like, there is something, I don't know, something noble about that, though. I think there's definitely, I have heard people talking, like, I have heard like heard conversations being had on podcasts between like people who grew up playing sports and people who didn't, saying like, well, the thing I missed out on is not so much that I really liked sport or would have enjoyed that kind of thing. It's that I never learned how to lose properly. And you did never learn how to be part of a team properly. And these kind of things that go way beyond what the sport actually is. So like there's like a mystique. There's a romanticism about the Olympics, even in a time where, morally speaking, they probably shouldn't happen. But I mean, there's a lot of gray areas with these things, and there's a lot of like positives and negatives, and like two things can be true at the same time. It's a weird one. It's definitely one where you need to do a little bit of a balancing act in your head and your heart. But at the same time, like, just focusing on the positive aspects of these things, the Olympics are amazing, and there's something that they offer that nothing else does. And I don't exactly know how to explain that any further, but I do think there's an aspect, like looking at the Euros now and the journey that England are on, and it's a little bit, I'm conflicted about this because I got a football team that has a relatively large consistent contingent of Englishmen in that team, which means I kind of can't handle when England do well all of a sudden. It's a bit difficult to hear about that constantly, about how it's coming home at Tuesday evenings, Tuesday, Thursday evenings, and then Saturday afternoons, a little bit too much. But I do think those other tournaments are capturing something of that same essence as well. I think the Olympics are the, to use an appropriate metaphor, the Olympics are the shining torch of it, though. It's like everyone else is sort of like feeding off of that flame.
I think the same premise applies to the World Test Championship final. And just on the cricket beat, we do also have a T20 World Cup coming up as well. So, and a Rugby League World Cup, hopefully. So I enjoy how these big events come around. It's a bit, just on that Rugby League beat, you see it with State of Origin, but from New Zealand, I look at State of Origin like, okay, this is cool, but it's just Aussies talking about Aussies. There's no necessarily correlation to me other than entertainment and the entertaining product, which isn't that entertaining when one team's winning by 40 plus points, as is the case in the NRL. So it's like, okay, if we can have a different context to rugby league events, which is a Rugby League World Cup that actually applies to me, that actually applies to Samoans and Tongans and Fijians and French and English folk, then it's all pretty amazing. So shout out to the events, and I think it's going to be cool if we do follow these events and these tournaments with the Almost Daily podcasts, and that way there is always going to be audio and like a podcast there to follow the events. And what you're talking about with England at the Euros, I think those events and those tournaments allow for narrative and stories to be told. You're watching a team progress through the tournament. They went through this moment and that moment, and then this moment came to be, and then that moment, and it all led to here. You saw that in the World Test Championship final over the course of just 6 days. Every day was a story. Even when there was just rain and there was no cricket, there was a story to be had about what was happening there. And over the course of a Euro tournament, you're seeing, okay, that was the hot team in the pool stages. Then this team made a tactical adjustment for this game, and then this gritty team is still gritting their teeth and playing through it all. It all comes together for just a more fun sporting experience.
Yeah, and the other factor there is when you get like all these teams in one place and or all these athletes in one place and everything, like, there are going to be occasions where you have Usain Bolt, who's just is gonna win. Like, we know he's gonna win. Michael Phelps, we know he's gonna win. Just the best by a comfortable margin. What you get in league play is that usually happens. Like, the best team over the, and that's the best thing about league play, to be fair. Like, the best team over the course of an entire season is going to be the team that finishes first. Like, it's almost like a filtering process, like, to be able to keep it up for that long. But in tournament play, a good 90 minutes, or, you know, just in a like Olympic contest, it might just be a good throw or a good like 10 second sprint or whatever, you know, like whatever it is, just one good day, one good event, one good like action could change the course of everything and spark a massive upset. And you get that so much more in tournament play, which is another aspect of why it's so much fun. And like, over the course of a league season at the Euros, for example, I think England would still be pretty high up there. But I don't think you'd have seen France get knocked out so early, for example. Like, they didn't even have one bad day. They just had 20 bad minutes. They took their eye off the ball at a point where they were 3-1 up. They sort of felt like they were coasting, and then they got sucker punched and couldn't change the momentum back from there. Like, that happens in tournament play. It is unpredictable in a way that, for example, the NRL right now is not, because you get, except when you get mid-table teams like the Dragons and Warriors playing each other, which we'll get to in a sec, that can be wild and unpredictable. But when the Storm are playing, they're probably going to win, and they're probably going to win by 40. When the Panthers are playing, they might win by even more than that. Like, there's not a lot of unpredictability in those results. There still is in these, like, tournament-y type stuff, and that's cool. That's awesome. What, just out of interest, what sports would you say you are most hyped for with the Olympics 2 weeks away?
I would say probably Lydia Ko in the golf is going to be really interesting. My, like, beat sports at the Olympics, hockey, the woman might get a medal, but no hopes there. Surfing's going to be really tough as well. Rugby sevens, don't really care. Then I look at, like, athletics is going to be really interesting for me, and you've kind of got me on the football wagon. So I'd say Lydia Ko, football and athletics, probably the most interesting for me. I'm assuming you're all over the football, right?
Yeah, definitely all over the football. I think both the men's and the women's squads are just intensely good. Like, we don't normally have squads this talented, and also just the timing of it, whereas, because the Football Ferns, it's not a very different squad to the World Cup squad from, you know, a couple years ago, but it is a team that's in a much better place. They still have the one glaring weakness, which is a lack of depth up front, but we'll see how that goes, because there's a few younger players who might be able to take big strides. But definitely, like, there are players who are in very good form coming off very good club seasons in that team right now, which was not really the case when the World Cup came around. Like, there's a few players who are always just at a high level, but there's also a few players, like Hannah Wilkinson was coming back from an ACL injury, and here she's, like, you know, fully fit, been playing regular games in Germany up until pretty recently, scoring a few goals, like things like stories like that. Like, Liv Chance was also coming back up a knee injury at the World Cup, was one of New Zealand's best players. She just had an outstanding season with Brisbane Roar in Australia. So stories like that just add to the hype. The women's football team have the worst imaginable draw, which is why it's hard to get too excited about, like, results or how they might go. I mean, you only really need to get one good win and not get thrashed in the other games, and you might sneak through as a third place qualifier, but that will be very difficult for them. The men's draw is the best case scenario, though. Like, you can look at the 16 teams who qualified for that men's Olympic football thing and make an argument that, like, four of the worst six teams in the tournament are in our group, including us. But people don't know what to expect from New Zealand at a major tournament, and this is a very stacked team that we have there, and it's exciting to see. Little less so because Sapreet Singh isn't there. I just think there's no one that quite fits their role that he would have played, which is a conundrum for Danny Hay, but definitely the football stuff is super exciting to see what happens there. Athletics is always enjoyable. Always like to see people throwing stuff really far and running really fast. That's great. Like, one of the events where you don't even need a New Zealander involved to be able to watch some of those ones. It's just enjoyable, full stop. Two other, like, a lot of the other ones you mentioned as well will be interesting. Like, I'm definitely going to be paying high attention to, like, I'm quite excited for surfing. I think surfing is quite a cool Olympic sport addition. I want to see how that goes. But two athletes I'll chuck up as well who are quite exciting, who have got a lot of media coverage and, like, over the last 12 months on their journey to this point. Lewis Clairbert, the swimmer, I think he's someone who seems to have a little bit of buzz around him and what he might be able to do. I think he's in the 200 meter and 400 meter individual medleys. So one of them jack of all trade type swimmers. We'll see what he can achieve, and also David Nico, who's the box heavyweight boxer who's been sort of like delaying his, like, because he missed out on the last Olympics and he's done so well at Commonwealth Games, and he's sort of been holding back his professional career in order to prioritize a proper go at the Olympics. And, you know, he's someone who, it's always tricky. Boxing is going to be, especially heavyweight boxing division, is going to be stacked at an Olympic Games. But he is someone who, yeah, you know, he's got the potential to go fairly far, and it'll be pretty cool to see how he goes as well.
I've just been listening to a couple podcasts about Game of Thrones, and they were based in Marine. So I've had the Sons of the Harpy in my mind for a week or so. And you mentioned Sarpreet Singh, and if Sarpreet Singh's playing for New Zealand, I think we have to call ourselves the Sons of Sarpy. I'm just going to put that out there. Let's crack into this absolutely disgustingly diablerical Niche Case Derby. The Warriors. I cover the Warriors in the Aotearoa Warriors Diary. You are, of course, a Dragons fan, and they played out a 19-18 game that the Dragons won. You've probably all heard the story. You've got Chad Townsend having a bit of a kerfuffle there. He was playing busted, which was kind of encouraging. The Dragons were good, and then the Dragons sucked, and then the Warriors sucked, and then the Dragons won. That's basically how the game went. It was a terrible game of rugby league. I just want to start here, though, Wildcard, as we touch on a few topics about from this game. This game is a quintessential Warriors fear game. I mentioned that a few weeks ago about the Warriors fear. The Warriors were up, you know, quite handsomely, 18-6 or something like that. And no Warriors fan would have been watching that game thinking, oh, this game is done. When Wade Egan jumped out of dummy half and Corey Norman decided not to split at the markers and went the same way as his other marker, I thought the Dragons might be off, which they were for patches, but somehow they still won. But point being that this is a game that Warriors fans have seen so often before, and the key thing there is that I don't think this result can reflect on badly on anyone at the Warriors right now. You know, you can't say, oh, this is Nathan Brown's fault, Nathan Brown's a shit coach, or, oh, Chad Townsend, he's a shit player because this happened, oh, the Warriors team is a shit team, when this specific performance has been present for 26 years. So it's not a individual thing at the Warriors, it's a Warriors thing. You know, this is just something that Warriors fans have had to dealt with their whole time. And I'm actually amazed that when you go through like all the different coaches the Warriors have had, all the different players, the different owners, the different CEOs, different everything, they have still managed to lose these games as part of the Warriors fabric, which is pretty crazy. How did you feel as a Dragons fan, specifically when the Warriors were up Wildcard? Did you feel like, oh, we can get back in this game? Or did you think that the Warriors are going to throw this game away? Were you a bit downhearted by some impressive Warriors minutes there in the middle of the game? Like, how were you just feeling as a Dragons fan when the Warriors appeared to be in control?
Yeah, it's funny that you say that no Warriors fan would have been comfortable, because, like, I thought they were completely comfortable. Like, the first 20-odd minutes were pretty good for the Dragons. That was fine. Then once the Warriors scored their first try, for the next, 50 minutes of that game, it was basically one team playing. It felt like the Dragons would make mistakes just in dumb places. They wouldn't capitalize when the Warriors would, if they were given an inch sort of thing, the Dragons would just refuse to take it. They were awful for large periods of that game, in a way that they have this habit of being this year. And I don't know, like, sometimes they look quite decent and really, like, up for the arm wrestle kind of thing. And then other games you get, like, the Bulldogs, for example, have won, I think, 2 games all season. Both were against the Dragons. Like, I don't know how that happens. They have these games where they just don't look like they know what they're doing. So I'm watching that game through the second half as the Warriors chip away. And, you know, they're up 18-6 with about half an hour to go, thinking the Dragons have got to score quickly if they're gonna you know, have any opportunity here. They're not a team that scores a heap of points anyway. They don't score for another 20 odd minutes, and then by which point I'm thinking, like, for sure the Warriors have got this in the bag. Like, it's not even close. Even when the Dragons scored the first try, like, Jared Beal got over, even then I'm like, well, that's a nice consolation, at least we're keeping it, like, semi-close. And obviously Corey Norman missed the conversion, because he missed every conversion he took on the day. He's just not a good kicker off the tee. And he's not the, like, Zach Lomax is injured. He would have otherwise been kicking. But, Christ, like, those opportunities are the kind of things that, as a Dragons fan, you're used to seeing. Like, they will kick, they will take the two from out in front. They, like, are the kind of team, ever since Wayne Bennett was there, that's just, like, been imprinted in the club, in the same way that Warriors collapses seems to be apparently imprinted in that club. Like, the Dragons will try to capitalize off the tee. So to have a situation where, like, they should have probably won more comfortably, shouldn't have gone to Golden Point with the tries that they scored at the end, and then just missing every kick, it just felt like every opportunity was being given to the Warriors to continue to win that game. One of those tries was someone like, I can't remember who it was, but just not clearing a kick into the end goal, and I think it was the second one. I think it's when Jack Bird scored. And then even then it went down to the very last play of the game. So, like, basically my experience of that match was, if Corey Norman had got the first conversion, and it was only a 6-point game with about 8 minutes left, then maybe I might have started to get a bit of hope. But basically, I had no thought that the Dragons, like, I didn't comprehend in my head that the Dragons might win that game until the very last play of the 80, when Cody Ramsey goes over in the corner from a quick shift, and suddenly there's space because the Warriors had overloaded a little bit more in the middle or on the other side or whatever it was, I can't remember, but spread the ball wide. And even then, like, even at that moment, it's not like the play the ball at that point, I'm thinking, hey, if the Dragons score, then they can take this to Golden Point or potentially win it. I'm thinking, why you go, like, the ball got sort of shifted from right to left. I think Hunt or Dufty, I forget which one it was, had the ball in their hand. Probably Ben Hunt, just thinking of how the game would normally unfold. And he shifts it even further left when Dufty was on his right cutting in or something like that. I forget. Like, that was what I was looking at. It's like, last play of the game. You need your best players to do something special here. I'm looking for Ben Hunt. I'm looking for Matt Dufty. Matt Dufty, because he's the only X-factor player in the team, and Ben Hunt because he was the only player who, up until that point, I would have given better than a 5 out of 10 on those performances. You seem like the only player who was doing anything. They went away from both of them, and then all of a sudden it just ended up in an easy try over in the corner. And honestly, like, my reaction was just pure laughter. I just cracked up. I thought, this is ridiculous. And then the Golden Point was pathetic from both teams, but someone had to win it, and the Warriors kept dropping the ball in their own half. So the Dragons got a little bit lucky there, but Corey Norman can't kick off the tee, but he can hit a field goal all right. So that was the experience of the last sort of 10 minutes plus Golden Point. But yeah, like, ridiculous game of rugby league, just an absolutely ridiculous game.
Yeah, I think, unfortunately for Edward Cosey, who Mangere East Hawks Jr., which I'll elaborate on in a second, he had a bit of a tough, I think he had a key hand in a couple of those Dragons try. Like, he couldn't clear the kick that you're referring to. He went down on a crusher tackle. I think the Warriors were a bit screwed over by the refs, but you probably think differently. But he went down for a crusher tackle that wasn't called. So then it's a slow play the ball. So then someone gets smashed and blah, blah, blah. He had a tough night. But I say that because it leads me to a bit of, like, I don't know. I'm kind of impressed at the Warriors' DNA being so prevalent that they lost that game. And I'm going to take those positive vibes into this next point, because I'm kind of low-key excited about the Warriors this season. Because I saw Dylan Martinez-Lesniak and Roger Tuivasa-Sheck both running the footy like madmen. And if you hadn't seen Martinez-Lesniak play much rugby league before, this dude runs very fast and very straight. That's all he does. He is an absolute psycho. He has no preservation at all about his personal health on the footy field. He only runs hard and straight. And he's like 25 years old or something like that. And Roger Tuivasa-Sheck, we all know what he does. He is an absolute weapon. So the Kossi thing, like, he's a developing player. He's going to get better, get more reps, and so on and so forth. But if you have Rhys Walsh at fullback, Roger Tuivasa-Sheck on one wing, Waitene Selesniak on the other wing, I think that is going to be pretty damn interesting. And then if you chuck in Matt Lodge, regardless of what you think about whether you like him as a person or not, it's not your choice to make necessarily because he's there, he's signed, he's playing in the NRL. Yeah, you can dislike him. He probably doesn't care, so don't worry about it. But if you add Matt Lodge, who I think in last Friday's email I said that he averages 2.2 offloads a game, which is among the best for the Warriors, and his meters per game is also among the best of the Warriors. You add Matt Lodge to Adam Fanua-Blake, and oh, it's just like now there's a Warriors team that is going to be, they're going to run hard, and they're going to make meters. And I was, that hit home. I was actually thinking about a tweet, like a 1-2 punch, Tuivasa-Sheck, Waitene Selesniak, meters per run, with a little gif, like 1-2 punch type of thing. And I was thinking about that mid-game, and then it all fell to shit. So I'm actually kind of interested in what the Warriors do moving forward this season with the addition of Waitene Selesniak and Matt Lodge, because they, what they're good at is what Adam Fanua-Blake's good at, is what Tuivasa-Sheck's good at, and that's making big meters down the field and scattering bodies and getting quick play the balls and so on. And that hit home when I was watching Waitene Selesniak run the footy, because he runs the footy like a madman, and it's absolutely beautiful.
Yeah, and had the Warriors held on and won that game, which they absolutely should have, like, is, I mean, if Chad Townsend had kicked that drop goal, if he had actually got the drop goal, then it probably...
Or didn't take the drop goal.
Well, yeah, well, the didn't take the drop goal is the easy one, because if you're smart, you just sort of kick that, like, rubber it into the corner, and either you get a repeat set, or you force the Dragons to play off their line instead of giving them a 7-tackle set with, like, a bit of a head of steam. Like, that's the simple thing, and if you do that, the Warriors probably win that game. But if he takes the drop goal and gets the drop goal, even then, the Warriors probably win that game. I'd say that's a slightly, just because of where you're, like, you're moving the ball back to halfway for a kickoff, you're changing the percentages a little bit. Like, the high percentage play is to grubber into the corner or something like that in that situation. But, like, if he had got the drop goal, I think they probably still would have won from that point, even though it doesn't make much difference to the, maybe he just knew Corey Norman was going to miss every kick, so it's the difference between 12-point lead and a 13-point lead rather than the 8 to 9 or whatever. I don't know. But if, like, the point being that it was right there for them to just control a little bit better. And to be fair, like, Townsend was playing with one arm, doing his best Cooper Cronk grand final with the Roosters impersonation. Like, that's probably a factor in kicking a drop goal, I've got to imagine. You do need to at least catch the ball first. Like, the game was there to be won. Like, even still, the mistakes that they made after the momentum started to shift make things look terrible. But, like, point being that it's almost a little bit like that World Cup final with the Black Caps, where just a whole lot of little things add up to be one major collapse. Wasn't a collapse from the Black Cats, but it was just when the margins were that close, little things make the difference. The Warriors, however, were in a position to win that game. Had they won that game, they would have been equal on points with the Dragons. They would then have had, what, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9. And the Dragons have been, 9 games left, that is. The Dragons have been in the top 8 basically all season, despite alternating between half decent and absolutely terrible at various stages. I don't know. It's just, I think it's just one of those seasons where like the barrier to make the top eight is going to be lower after the top sort of six teams, probably. Top six teams you can absolutely set in stone. It's pretty clear. The other two spots is about, you know, I think Cooper Cronk was saying on the tele coverage the other day, like basically every team except the Bulldogs and the Broncos are still in the mix there. And the Broncos won yesterday since then, so maybe they're even still in the mix. But like the Warriors have a kind of favorable running in those like across these nine games. They've got Sharks next week, Panthers at a time when the Panthers are going to be without potentially both of their halves. Like it's just it's a favorable time to be playing the Panthers. Rabbitohs away is tricky. Tigers away. Then you Sharks at Central Coast Stadium is a technical home game. Bulldogs at Mount Smart, which is going to be like packed out. One of them great occasions, like when the Phoenix came back to New Zealand and played. And Broncos, Raiders, Titans, like these. Considering that state of the Panthers, I mean, the Rabbitohs will be tough. Like, Rabbitohs is probably the one game where they're definitely not going to be favored there. Don't know what to expect from them against a weakened Panthers team. But, like, there's seven wins in there if the Warriors turn up and if they, like, some of these new signings deliver. And, like, that's a lot to be, like, it sort of feels like another loss, another, like, devastating moment, like, even just really just 10 minutes that screwed that up for the Warriors. But despite that feeling, like they're 2 points off Cronulla, who are eighth right now. Points difference is a factor, got to pick that up. But then every points difference is a factor for every team outside the top four or five, because those teams are thrashing everybody else. So everyone's got negative points difference. Like the Warriors are still right in this mix. So what you're saying about like the positives from that, it's, I like looking at it from a little bit more of a neutral perspective. I don't see that as too much of a bridge to climb, like in my head, to imagine the Warriors sneaking into the top eight. I don't think that's anywhere near out of the realms of possibility.
Righto. We also had a Kiwi NRL debut for Falakiko Manu, who debuted at centre for the Bulldogs when they got absolutely walloped by the Manly Sea Eagles. This is interesting for two parts. First is Falakiko Manu's journey, which I included a snippet of in the email today on Monday. He left New Zealand, Auckland, where he was a Mangere East Hawks junior. He went to school with Ipswich State in Australia. And then he went to the Bulldogs under 20s and he fell off after that. And then he was sleeping in his car. And as late as February this year, he was sleeping in like a back room of where he worked, which is a panel beater's. And his boss was nice enough, after he found out he was sleeping in a car, he was nice enough to put him up in a room at his workplace. And now he is an NRL player, which is pretty cool. For Falakiko Manu, he is the seventh Kiwi NRL debutant this year after Wiramu Greig, Edward Kosi, Rocco Berry, Taniela Otukulo, Simi Sasangi, T.C. Robati, and Manu, Falakiko Manu. And he is the third Mangere East Hawks junior to debut this year. Edward Kosi, Mangere East Hawks junior, and Greg Mazu, who I actually forgot there. Greg Mazu is also a Mangere East Hawks junior who debuted for the Gold Coast Titans on the wing. So I believe we might have eight Kiwi NRL debutants already this year. Remember last year we had 13 Kiwi NRL debutants and we've got three from Mangere East Hawks, which is pretty epic. Not sure, Falakiko Manu made his debut due to some COVID complications with the Bulldogs, so it'll be interesting to see how he progresses through the rest of this season. Also wildcard, at the time of recording, we are coming at you after day one of the Somerset versus Leicestershire County Championship game, in which Devon Conway hit 88, opening the batting for Somerset. This is Devon Conway's first County Championship game ever, specifically this year. And it comes after Devin Conway had a pretty excellent start to the T20 Blast in England. He has 5 games in the T20 Blast, and he has 235 runs and an average of 78.33 and a strike rate of 126. So if we go, these are Devin Conway's scores just in England. 200, 23, 80, 3, 54, 19, 5, 51 not out, 53, 81 not out, 45, and then 88 overnight. Devin Conway is absolutely on fire, and he's like, the thing about Devin Conway in New Zealand last summer was that he was on fire in every format at every level he had played. Right now, it's just a continuation of that because he had 200 test debut against England at Lords, and then the World Test Championship final, 54 there as well. Now, big runs in the T20 Blast, moves into County Championship cricket against the Duke ball that moves around so much that's so difficult to face. Devin Conway says, fuck that. Test scores, T20 scores, County Championship scores. Devin Conway is absolutely on fire. How do you feel about it, Wildcard?
Love it. It's just that continuation that you're talking about. I will admit my first thought on seeing the seeing that he'd put up another lovely score in a county championship game was to think, why are they playing county championship cricket when they were like 3 days ago playing 2020 cricket? And I think maybe this is another example of some confusion between where priorities ought to lie in within English cricket and their domestic, it's not just their domestic, it flows into their international calendar. But I just think that's a little bit strange, because it was only a couple of days ago I was getting up and checking through some scores and noticing that Lockie Ferguson and Adam Milne had both taken hat-tricks on the same day of the 2020 Blast, and both of them bowling, I think they were both the last three balls of the innings as well, which is probably the easiest three balls to get a hat-trick on, to be fair, because guys have got no choice but to swing the bat, but still got to get them out, still got to beat them somehow there. And that's, two import guys, both from New Zealand, both pretty much well in the 2020 international mix at the moment, and as you said earlier, a World Cup year. Very exciting to note that. But with Devin Conway, it's just more, I don't know, it's just more Devin Conway news. I'd, at this point, I'd be more surprised if he didn't score runs.
That would definitely be surprising. Devin Conway is going to play in the 100. So the reason the T20 Blast has stopped is to make way for the 100. And of course, it's just a great idea to play the 100 and County Championship at the same time. So shout out to that. I was a bit confused by Adam Milne. So Adam Milne, I'm looking forward to this summer because he is going to be, I think he's a CD Stags contracted player. So hopefully he can play some red ball cricket and Ford Trophy and stuff like that. But he took that hat trick, which is great. But he's not doing a whole lot else. Super Smash last year, didn't play. He was in the Big Bash. 5 wickets and an average of 66. Then he went to the Indian Premier League. He bowled 4 3 overs at 11 runs per over in his only game. And I think he took all 4 of his... He's only played 2 games of T20 Blast. And he took all 4 of his wickets in that hat-trick performance. And he is going at 10 runs and over. So it's just so confusing. Is Adam Milne going to be a T20 World Cup player? Hat-trick, T20 Blast. Oh my God, it's amazing. That stuff is all cool. And I can see people getting excited about it. But having followed Adam Milne on the T20 circuit, which he has made a concerted effort just to be on the T20 circuit, his work on the T20 circuit doesn't necessarily stack up to warranting selection over other players. But I'm just saying that because I'm open-minded with what he's going to do. And if you look at his last 10 games on the Crick Info profile, his best work came in T20 internationals against Bangladesh last summer. All of his last 10 games are all T20s, and he's got 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. Half of those games he hasn't taken a wicket in, and 3 of those games he's taken 1 wicket in. So in 8 of those 10 games, all of which are T20 games, he has taken 1 wicket or less in 8 of those games. So, I don't know, like, listeners, yourself, Wildcard, you can be the judge, but it's dubious as it stands right now, but it's open for development because Adam Milne is also in the 100. Like, he's getting signed as if he's a, you know, white ball superstar, which he's a handy white ball bowler by all accounts, and he will be in the 100 as well. So it'd be interesting to see what happens there. We have... Yeah, go on.
He's pure pace, so I guess that all... That, like, we've seen plenty of bowlers before, haven't we, who can bowl, like, 150 clicks, and they get pushed into a position a little bit beyond what they're capable of. I think Adam Milne, like, his best performance at the Big Bash, I remember, was when he, like... I'm pretty sure it was a wicketless game, wasn't it? When he went 4 overs for 8 runs or something like that. There was a game like that, something in those areas. And he does seem to be that kind of guy. Like, he's quick, he bounces, he gets some of that nice, like, up and down kind of bounce. You can just imagine why a traveling Bangladeshi team would have trouble with that. You can also imagine why on Indian pitches that would go for 11s and over. So he is in a funky place, eh? Because my perspective on guys like that who have had long times out with injury, it's like I'm not even going to make a judgment on the comeback. Like, people always react to the comeback like that's the great thing. I'm sort of like sitting back, pumping the brakes a little bit, being like, well, let's see him play 10 games in a row or whatever, especially if he's only going to focus on 2020. Like, let's see him have a whole series where he continues to deliver very well. And I think he's at that point now. Like, he's played enough consistent cricket over the last 12 months or whatever without having, like, big injury setbacks like he kept doing before. Because he came onto the scene so young, he's still pretty young. Like, he's the age now that most guys... He feels like he should be 36 because he's been around long enough. But he is now the age that most bowlers are in the black cap setup, at least. Other countries are different. Where you're first coming through into the first team. Like, I don't imagine he would be that much older than... It'd be, what, 2 or 3 years older than Kyle Jamieson, probably? And that, like, I think he's at that point now where we can start making judgments about where he stands going forward because he's played that, like, bulk of games. But, yeah, that's where it gets confusing because he doesn't seem to be a big wicket taker, does he? And yet he just took a hat-trick. I think his prospects for a 2020 World Cup squad would have been a lot better after that hat-trick had Lockie Ferguson, who's probably his main rival, not also taken a hat-trick at the exact same time. That's probably a bit of a stink one where Adam Milne's feeling like, yeah, I've just made this great, coming off the field, just made this great statement for myself about where I ought to be in the, like, to put myself into the consideration for that 2020 squad and then also another rival for that spot. You'd be happy to, like, they'll be happy for each other at the same time. This Black Caps obviously isn't an environment where people are aggressive or overly competitive with each other or anything like that, but there's probably a little bit of a, like, oh shit, Lockie did it too, oh well.
Rightio, we have bemoaned a bit of a lack of Kiwi vibes at the New Zealand Breakers, but we'll finish with the addition of Yanni Wetzel, who by all accounts from yourself was one of the best Kiwis in the NBL last season, and now he's with the Breakers. So how do you just feel about it? Obviously a good move adding someone like Yanni Wetzel.
Yeah, I think it's a fantastic move. I would say he was the best non-breaker of the New Zealanders in the NBL last season. And obviously when you look at the Breakers had like wasn't the best season for Corey Webster, largely due to injuries, but Ty Webster for sure was pretty strong, and Finn Delaney was just brilliant. Outside of that, you have, yeah, I think Yanni Wetzel is the dude, and he, his is an interesting career, because I thought So he comes back from college in the States, where I can't remember where he went now. But he missed out on his last national tournament, which obviously would have been the one where he was in the best position to sort of showcase himself. Missed out on that because it was cancelled because of COVID. Comes back to New Zealand, does, I even remember seeing a couple like, sports news, like roundups of sort of him. I remember there being one where he was like talking from the other side of the gate because he was still in quarantine. He trained with the Breakers over off season, and it sort of felt like he was a guy who the Breakers, because he's an Aucklander as well. So it just sort of felt like that was an obvious target for the Breakers. And then he went and signed with Southeast Melbourne. Signs a 3-year deal, and then opts out of it after just about a month or something, because he gets another option. He had like a sort of clause in his contract, a European out clause, so he was going to go play in Germany, does actually go, like, opts out, goes to Germany, and then has trouble sort of getting his passport or visa or whatever it is, like just getting himself registered there, and got a bit difficult, and it was taking too long, so he comes back to Southeast Melbourne Phoenix. I assumed he had opted back into that contract, but he seems to have been a free agent at the end of the season. So I guess maybe he just came back on a 1-year deal, not the original contract that he had. Plays fantastically for them. Like he's a big man, probably a little bit undersized as a center, but he does make up for that because he's a good shooter, in the paint. He's not someone who will hit 3-pointers like Rob Lowe, at least not yet, but, you know, pretty good defender, moves very well on his feet, rebounds decently for his size. There's a lot of stuff he could, like, all of these things are things he could improve on and will need to improve on if he's going to play, like, the type of role that the Breakers used Colton Iverson for example. Like, he's considerably taller than Wetzel, so, and he's there as a rebounder and a, like, rim runner. That's very different to how Wetzel would play. But just in pure talent, like, he's an outstanding signing for the Breakers and the kind of guy they probably should have got a year ago. And I will say, like, a lot of criticism about the Breakers that that we and that others have thrown at them for the way they've sort of dismantled the kind of Kiwi Tall Blacks identity that they had going there for a little while. And that sort of comes into, I think, a wider critique of how they've operated under their current ownership ever since that took over. One thing I will say about Matt Walsh and their current ownership is that they're pretty good at seeing where they went wrong. It's not like just a completely arrogant, sort of like got your blinders on kind of thing. We're doing this right, kind of, everyone else has got to get in line. It's not that kind of thing. They definitely, at the end of each season, you'll hear admitting mistakes that were made and whatever, and they will look to correct those things. I remember after the first season, I remember Walsh doing an interview with the NBL sort of league media, talking about how he thought they would be more accepted from the outset than they were, and they realized they had to do more work to win over fans. And I think they've done a lot better in that aspect since. And admitting some of the mistakes with roster signings and preseason from last season going into this season was definitely something they improved on. And now signing Yanni Wetzel was someone who had gotten away from them in the first place. And Sam Timmons as well, a Kiwi big man, another guy who did quite well at college, who's come back. He's a development player for next season. That's quite a cool signing as well, particularly if he actually gets some minutes, unlike their development guys from this current past season. That's all cool. Like that's another correction that's been made. It's just the one thing I will say is, like, maybe don't make these mistakes in the first place when they seem a little bit obvious. Like, you don't really just rock up in another country and assume everyone's going to accept you from the outset, when you're taking over and changing things. And, if there are obviously talented, like, local signings who you could be getting, and you're allowing them to sign with Australian clubs as well, like Isaiah Marihuliafa seems like another guy who would have fit that bill very nicely, considering he was only a DP for Southeast Melbourne, a teammate of Wetzel's last season. He's re-upped with them, so he's, you know, not someone who's going to pop. Jack Salt, I've just seen as well, has signed a 1-year deal with Brisbane, I think it is, which is a funky little tandem they'll have there, because they'll have Jack Salt and Tyrell Harrison, so they'll have a Kiwi big man rotation. Can't wait for that. That's like, Yeah, it's nice that the Breakers are seemingly open to correcting some of the errors, but maybe also you don't need to make these mistakes in the first place, or maybe leave it at that.
Boom shakalaka. That was a delicious smorgasbord of Kiwi sporting goodness. We will be back later in the week for another episode of the Niche Cast. Until then, plenty of writing to be done on the niche-case.com. I've written about the Kiwi batsmen in the T20 Blast. I'll write about the Kiwi bowlers in the T20 Blast. I'll write about New Zealand Warriors optimism. What do you got coming up? Flying Kiwis wildcard?
Flying Kiwis, absolutely. I've just finished the quotable Stephen Adams for another season, which is sort of like a compiling his best quotes from the last season to tell the story in a like oral history type of way, but only using his own words. That's up. That's live. Since we're just talking about the NBL, I've written a thing sort of rounding up the different New Zealanders from there. That was stuff that went up late last week. And I'll tell you what, I think I might start turning my attentions towards some Olympic stuff. I'm starting to think.
Beauty. Kia kaha. Stay beautiful. Cheer, cheer.